have Owen Newcomer with us and Nick Donovan. Mr. Vinatieri did decline to come here today. I do want to remind everyone that the League of Women Voters will be having their event as well on Tuesday, if I'm not mistaken. What time?
7 o'clock, City Hall.
7 o'clock, City Hall, okay? Tuesday. Okay, Owen, I'm going to go ahead and have you open up with your statement.
Thank you very much, and I want to thank you for coming today. This is a very important event, and obviously a very important election. I'm Councilman Owen Newcomer. I'm in my 41st year teaching political science at the Rio Hondo Community College, now a retired part-time teacher, and 16 years on the City Council. I believe I'm the best candidate for the mayor for three basic areas. One, I have the most experience in government as a teacher, most experience as an elected representative, having been a school board member from 89 to 2000, and now a council member since 2000. I also believe that I am the most committed between the top candidates to this new system. I'm the one who signed the argument on the ballot statement for the new district systems with the citywide elected mayor. None of my colleagues on the City Council supported it. None of them joined me in signing that. I am committed to making it work. I think it's going to be a better system, but it needs somebody to make sure it works. I think I can do that job. And I'm most in tune with the residents. I'm the one that's walked every door of a likely voter for every election I've been in. I started walking precincts in early January, and yesterday I went past my 4,000th house that I've been to visit. That's a commitment, but it also means I see firsthand what's going on in the neighborhoods, and I am there to respond to the residents. I'm also the only city council member that puts his personal phone number on the city webpage so you can get in touch with me. I'm the only one that puts his personal email on the city webpage, and I've done that ever since I got elected in 2000. It's not something I do 2 weeks before the election and then take it down after the election. I'm in tune with the district, also as a teacher. 80% of my students for the past 41 years have been Hispanic students in my classes at Rio Hondo College. I think I know how to do this. I think I can represent you better, and I'm looking forward to the issues today to demonstrate that I can be your best representative and your best voice on the Whittier City Council. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. My name is Nick Donovan, a third-time challenger to the incumbent city council. I ran for city council in 2012 and 2014, and ran, why? Because the past 6 years I've been witnessing some very dysfunctional behavior in City Hall. The first expose to that for me obviously was the Whittier Hills Oil Project. I was one of the original founders of the Whittier Hills Oil Watch Group and pretty much led that fight with some very committed individuals to do what? To do what was right for the community. We were a very informed bunch of individuals that understood the impacts of urban oil and gas drilling. I was a very informed individual about the impacts of climate change and the use of fossil fuels. I was a very informed individual about the upcoming drought that we've been known about for many, many years. Subsequently on to that, with a lawsuit which we won, which has wasted millions and millions of taxpayer dollars, we then moved on to a districting issue, an issue in 2014 again that I supported. Actually, the whole entire city council was originally against the request by a group of individual members of the community, once again, to move our city council elections to a districting system, 5 districts, and to move the date to a November date. Why? Because one, increased voter participation. I'm one of the original founders of this group that actually started this event today, so I'm very proud to see this come to fruition. I'm the senior vice president for one of the largest financial institutions on the planet. My day-to-day business is helping large companies succeed financially across the world. My experience is immense. My commitment to the community is passionate. And I think now it's time for a change. Enough is enough. We've wasted too much money. We need to move in a new direction, and this is your opportunity. Thank you. They want me to sing a song. Any requests?
Okay, candidates, we do have some questions from our audience. First question is, if elected as our first directly elected mayor, how would you reduce our 2017 Whittier City budget deficit? Nick?
How would I reduce it?
Well, on that great question, first thing, I wasn't a supporter of a four-district system with an at-large mayor. So this is a unique situation that we're in, and one that I didn't support, but we got it, we're dealing with it, so that's why I'm here today. The budget deficit, obviously, that exists and somewhat been ignored and or misreported on by our city council manager, Jeff Collier, and numerous press reports, because unfortunately our local media doesn't quite consistently repeat the truth. It's in existence. Why? Obviously, we've got financial issues because we waste a lot of money. I mean, we're doing the numbers right now on the oil issue, and it's more than several million dollars in costs that have been put on the city taxpayer that we've been told is going to be picked up by the oil company, but I can assure you that it won't be. Districting issue cost us about $2.5 million in legal fees that we've lost. We've got multiple lawsuits going on right now with the Nellis project. We've got lawsuits with trash contracts. I think we need to make better decisions on how we do business and make smart business decisions so we don't waste what the taxpayers already give us. Thank you. There's two big ways I think we need to deal with the deficit that's coming up. And if they work, we're done. If not, we got a backup plan. First of all, if the petition for the trash contract achieves enough signatures, the city council will have the option of, instead of allowing an election to take place, to simply cancel the contract that the petition seeks to cancel. What that will do is save $200,000, because the new Athens contract is bad for the city and will worsen the city's deficit by $200,000 next year. Second, though, we have historically been able to lease our unused water rights. There's a possibility, even with the drought, we have saved enough that we will be able to lease some water next year to surrounding cities. That would, last year, brought in $1.8 million. By itself, that would solve our deficit. If those things can't be done or aren't sufficient, I've long advocated three approaches, and you do it in balance. You cut a little, you find new sources of revenue, like leasing out water rates, and you draw on those reserves to get you through to the next year. We kind of get an opportunity to respond to each other's questions, so it's a pretty good format. I like it. Just in addition to what Owen just said, I mean, I just want to go back, because 1 minute's not a lot of time. You know, it's about smart decision making. You know, I have to make smart business decisions for my clients every day that do business around the world and throughout this country. That's what they hire me for. Same thing as a council member and as a mayor. You got to make smart decisions. You got to make informed decisions. If we never proceeded on the oil project, we'd be millions of dollars ahead. If we listened to the community on the districting issue, we'd be millions of dollars ahead. We're going to get the same punch in the face on the Nellis project. It's going in the wrong direction. We'll get the same thing on the trash contract. We've got to bring people into the city council that actually have a vision and have an understanding of what's going on in the world, an understanding of business, and understanding what community needs are, so that we cannot continue to make these same mistakes. Incumbent city council members have had decades to do this. It's not working. It's time for a change. Enough is enough.
Okay, candidates, our next question is, we want a mayor who really listens to the concerns of the people of Whittier. Will you, and how? Owen?
Thank you very much. Well, I started mentioning that, my openness to individuals. I'm the only one that puts the phone number on the webpage. I'm the only one that puts my email on the webpage. That way, when residents want to talk to me, it's easy to get a hold of me. Also, by going out and walking those precincts, I'm available. I see individual issues in the neighborhood at their door. And that opens up. Hey, somebody came to my door, I'm going to remember him and I'm going to call him when I have a question. That works, and people do it. I am very available. I go to as many events as I can, and I go to all the forums. It's a way to get out there and communicate with folks. I can't guarantee to solve every problem. I can't guarantee to agree with everybody that has an issue. But I do pledge to always listen, always be respectful, and try to find a solution that is a win-win for everybody. I've done it for 16 years. I'll do it as mayor.
We have an average turnout in April elections of about 11%. I speak to a lot of people that don't participate in city council elections because they don't think the city council listens. When you've got a split community that actually is divided by partisanship, I mean, we've got a very entrenched Republican community, and we've got a somewhat supportive Democratic community, to supposed other candidates that purport to be Democrats. 11% turnout is about 5,000 people there, according to 46,000 registered voters. So the people I talk to are mostly outside that community who don't participate, who want to get involved, but they feel that there's not a voice. I've been an engaged and very active community member in when you listen to somebody else talking in the background, it's a distraction. When you're out there pumping the streets and talking to people that don't vote because they don't feel engaged and they don't have a voice, then I think something's not working. 11% turnout isn't a good reflection of that. Let's move to November elections. Let's get more people engaged. That's what I support.
I would also add one thing. If there's going to be communication as we need there to be, you need respect. As a council member, I need to respect those who are calling me. I need to respect those who are talking at city council meeting. I need to respect those who have opinions that are different. And I do. It is my goal. I think I accomplished that goal. And once you start with respect, the communication is easy. It does not guarantee agreement. It does not guarantee that we can get the state to do what we want it to do, or we get the federal government to do what we want it to do. But it does mean that with respect, we can find common areas that we can work together and try to bring about that solution. And I think the record of my many years in representative government is a good record of finding solutions. Finding solutions when I was on the school board, finding solutions as a city council member, and being able to find solutions as a mayor who's looking out that everybody gets heard and everybody has a voice.
Candidates, why are federal funds being used for a parking garage when other projects like affordable housing for students aren't being addressed? Nick?
Good question.
That was great.
Oh.
Sorry, could you read it? Sorry. One more time.
Why are federal funds being used for a parking garage when other projects like affordable housing for residents aren't being addressed?
Question of priorities, I suppose. I mean, we've got a... this all goes back to a much bigger issue, which is I'm sorry. Pick everything up when I'm speaking. Goes back to a bigger issue of where you put your priorities and how you spend your money. I mean, the parking garage, Uptown specific plan. One of my big passions has been to get some sort of commitment to getting the Uptown specific area back to where it should be, to be a shining light for this community, to be that sort of economic draw that we'd all like it to be. I consistently hear from people who come into the city, what a beautiful city, what a great place. I go to Uptown, looks wonderful, but I mean, you've got a lot of opportunity there, but some work to do. We talked about this in 2012, we talked about it in 2014, and we had an Uptown specific plan. I'm told that we spent hundreds of thousands of dollars to give us the roadmap, the blueprint, done in 2006, 7 or 8, somewhere around. But we've never used it. So why we're dumping $9.2 million that was mentioned the other day into a new structure when we wanted an existing parking structure where there was already a game plan to fix the existing parking structure just doesn't make economic sense to me. So it goes back to decision making and how you understand what's going on in the world.
The key is the restrictions on the funds and what the funds can be used for. The main goal of the economic redevelopment funds, and it's done with, redevelopment's done away with, but we still have money when it existed, is for economic development. The single biggest request we hear from the Uptown businesses, from the Uptown residents, and from the people that go to Uptown is you need more parking. And thus why parking structure becomes very important to making the economic viability of Uptown better. Now, that funds will only go forward if we can get buy-in from the property owners in Uptown and they form a business improvement district. So what we're doing at the moment is drawing up the plans for what it would look like so that we can go to those property owners and say, here's something real. If you create a business improvement district and you put your money up, this is what you're going to get in partnership with the city. We have been pushing for affordable housing funding from the state of California, and we'll come back to that.
Just in addition, we've got this 1 minute time frame, so you've got to speak really quickly to get a point across. Going back to this issue of how you allocate and spend money and resources, again, going back to smart decision making, there's been numerous bad decisions made that have impacted our budget. There's been money put on the table, spent in various directions that could have gone in somewhere else, whether it went to affordable housing, whether it went to help the homeless. But again, smart decision making, smart business decisions. You know, you've got to have people that actually get engaged and have a vision and have a background of experience of what's going on in the world, so that when you come to making some very significant decisions in spending money, that they're prudent and they're particularly well thought out. So I appreciate where the city council's coming. They're stepping in now in the last couple of weeks because they're trying to do something for Uptown. But again, allocation of resources and managing a budget is something that I have great experience at. And I don't get enough time to answer my question.
The next question, candidates. It has been discovered the city had already made a deal with the oil companies in March of 2008 prior to the city going to bid in August of that same year. The document known as the Whittier Main Field Agreement spells out terms of a lease. Why would the city sign such a document and circumvent the bid process which gave Matrix the oil project and locks out any other potential bidders? Be advised that Owen Newcomer's name is on the document. Owen?
Well, I would disagree a little bit with the interpretation, but let me go to the heart of what I think the issue is. Is the city going to appeal the latest court decision? The answer is no. The city is not going to appeal it. Is the oil project dead? Yes, the oil project is dead. So, going back to what was in there or not and arguing over the interpretation, I would beg to differ with the interpretation, but the key, it's dead. We're not appealing the most recent decision. It's no longer an issue that we're pushing. It's no longer an issue that we're looking to fit into our budget. It is dead.
As someone that was front and center in the oil fight and witnessed, obviously, years of manipulation and bad decision making. Yes, the project is dead, but the costs associated to the project are still ongoing. There's another three, or at least three, if not four, lawsuits that are out there, county to the city to the county, matrix to the county, matrix to the city, matrix. It's all over the place. As of last week, there was one of those court cases was resolved. I don't know what the final settlement was, but again, we've been incurring hundreds of thousands of dollars of legal bills along the way to pay for this. It's very difficult to answer a question in a minute and talk about fiscal, you know, issues within this city when you're seeing millions and millions of dollars continually wasted on bad decision making. So I keep dragging myself back to this point. We need some fresh eyes, some fresh experience, some new vision so that we can't keep making these same mistakes. The proof's in the pudding. I can't make it any simpler than that. I'm not Superman, I don't have all the answers to questions, but I do have the experience of knowing what a smart decision is. Thank you.
We keep hearing about the great legal costs to the city for these issues, and the reality is the oil company picks up all the legal costs. There is no cost to the city general fund. There is no cost to the city's reserves fund. There is no cost to, well, pick any fund you want. The city is not the one paying for the legal cost ultimately. The oil company paid for that. And those main battles are over. So the issue has been resolved. It will not have cost the city voters any money. And it's time to move on and look at other areas that we can move ahead, bring new businesses into town, improve housing, open up park space, and we have a lot of needs. We don't need to keep going and rehashing what's already been done. No cost to the city, it's dead.
Just my response to that, actually, is that's a matter of debate. We're pulling financial records from the city as we speak, and that doesn't prove to be the case. Case in point, City of Hermosa. The City of Hermosa did a very similar thing to what the City of Council, City of Whittier did a few years ago. They jumped into an oil and gas lease contract behind the City Council, behind the City Voters' backs. City voters put it on the ballot initiative, turned it around, shut the project down. The oil company came back to the City of Hermosa, sued them for tens of millions of dollars. The settlement resulted in about a $17.5 million settlement that the City of Hermosa had to eat. So I don't agree with Mr. Newcomer's full explanation there. I do have the fear of the backlash from Matrix Oil. They're not going to walk away from a $6 or $7 million investment that they made to start this project. And the knock-on from the Hermosa Beach lawsuit was that the oil company said not only would they sue them for their expenses, they're going to sue them for future loss of revenues. That's why there was such a high settlement. We still have that risk out there, and it hasn't been resolved. Thank you.
And the question is for you, Owen. Can you name issues where you have been in opposition to the majority of the council?
Thank you. Like the opportunity of the Athens trash contract. I was the sole council member that voted against the Athens contract. Water rates. I was the sole council member that advocated for pricing based on how much water you use so that you would benefit and be rewarded when you conserve because you'd save real money. And it would provide an incentive for more conservation long-term, not just through an immediate problem. I was the only one. I was also the only council member that advocated and voted for increased social service spending. We gave an increase to the Chamber of Commerce. We did not give a similar increase to our social services. We're actually spending less on social service now than we did 20 years ago as a percentage of our budget. I have advocated that we double our social service spending, get back to the percentage we had 20 years ago, and that be funds going to the nonprofits in town to help our seniors, to help individuals who are homeless, to help children in need of care. It's a lot of need, and those are three key issues.
Just in response to that, and we thank as one of the folks against the Athens trash contract, simply because of the process. As I said publicly numerous times, I had nothing against Athens. I know the company fairly well. But I did have a big problem with the process. And the process was very reflective of most of the processes that this city council's put forward over recent decades, where you've got a community saying one thing and you've got a group of small individuals saying another, and the only people that have supported the city council are their own immediate community. They're part of that 10% or that 11%. On the water rates issue, the biggest problem for me with water rates, and it sort of encompasses everything I'm saying today, there was an individual that came up to speak at that council meeting. I sat in nearly every one of those meetings and those discussions, those deliberations. Former council employee, and she said this. She asked this exact question of Mr. Henderson. You used to keep a fund, a rainy day fund for the future improvement and management of our existing water structure, water and sewage structure. What happened to all that money? What happened to that fund? My point is that this city council has done nothing to prepare for the rainy day. We've spent money willy-nilly, and we haven't prepared those things that we have to deal with now. The infrastructure of this city is a major issue. That's one of the reasons that they had to address impacted in water rate increases. Bad planning, lack of vision.
And we are improving our water system. I mean, we've got 100-year-old pipes in some places, and that's not acceptable. The key, though, areas where we disagree. Let me bring up one that's already been mentioned, but I want to focus on it here. The district election system. I was the only member of the city council to support the new election system. The only member of the city council to support the mayor as a checks and balance system. Maybe that comes from my old political science teaching, where checks and balances is a good concept for government. But those are areas where we differ, I differ, with the city council.
Okay, no response, no? Okay. Oh, okay, sorry. Keep going.
You'll need him for
the
next one.
Oh, excellent. So
much fun. Okay, candidates, what are the responsibilities of the city attorney and his staff? Seems like all legal issues are contracted out to outside counsel. Please explain, Nick.
Well, I'm not an expert on the actual governmental reasoning to that specific question. My only comment on the city attorney, Greg, Mr. Dick Jones, dear friend of Mr. former council member Greg Nordback, good golfing buddy. Mr. Jones is a great example of what's one of my problems with this city council and many folks that I talk to. An entrenched, old, consistent supporter of many bad decisions. And when you're in business, as I am in my own business with the companies that I work with throughout this country, you hire me to tell you what you need to hear, not what you want to hear. Unfortunately, Mr. Jones has been a tell you what you want to hear and not what you need to hear. One of the first things I'd like to see is actually possibly Mr. Jones to end his career at Whittier City Hall. He's cost us millions. And when the trouble with lawyers is when you step into a legal battle, it's a win-win situation. Whether you win or lose, you get paid. Whether you win or lose, you get paid. He's got a losing record. And why no city council member is taking him to task and putting him out of business, I have no idea. He's being investigated. If you don't know, do your research on Mr. Jones.
First, the objective. What's the role? They advise the city and they represent the city. Why sometimes do we need an outside council? Well, we'll use one example. And Suburban Water had a contract they needed to sign with the city of Whittier. Mr. Jones serves Suburban Water. He thus has a conflict of interest of serving them and serving us. And when there's a conflict of interest, we go to another lawyer. Sometimes that can be within the firm, sometimes it needs to be outside the firm. Now, does Dick Jones do a good job? Yes. Dick Jones is a leader in the field of representing cities and municipal governments. His firm of Jones and Mayer is one of the top firms in the state of California. Does that mean that we win every case? No, but that doesn't mean that we have bad advice or that we have a city attorney that needs changing. He does a very good job. His firm does a very good job. And I think we need to focus on more important issues than personalities of who serves us. Don't blame the messenger for the message.
And just in response to that, it's not about personalities, it's about the quality of the work that that individual does and the outcomes that are delivered to the city. So I'd only argue that, again, it's nothing personal, but Mr. Jones has got a tremendous losing record. So whether you take it on the oil issue, whether you take it on the voting rights issue, and going back to the voting rights issue, remember what the plaintiff's plea was. They didn't want four districts and an at-large mayor. They wanted five districts and a November election day. That was the argument. I sat in most of the case, the courtroom hearings, and that's what the plaintiffs were looking for. The city council's remedy of four and one was something that they thought could head the lawsuit off of the patch. We still incurred the debt of the lawsuit. I think the plaintiff's bills were well over $700,000, and Mr. Jones's bill is close to $2 million. So, I mean, I don't know, this doesn't sort of match up to a lot of common sense to me. The planters didn't get what they want. We got a hybrid system. It wasn't even the system that the consultant that was hired to put forward the districting issue wasn't even one we adopted. That was one adopted by a friend of Mr. Benetieri's. So, I mean, the truth, the facts are the facts, and the truth is the truth. Is this good decision making? I don't think so.
Hey, candidates, I heard that the city is applying for the All-American City Award. Why is the city applying to waste approximately $30,000 when it has never won this award? As a young voter, why should I care about this award? Owen?
Well, if I can have four or five things that I disagree with my colleagues. I did vote against spending the money, and more importantly, devoting the staff time to preparing an application this year for the American Cities Award. It's a great thing to have, but I kind of think we're an all-American city without somebody requiring me to pay $50,000 to $100,000 to go to their place and do a song and dance for them in order for them to tell me I'm a great city. I think we are a great city. It's a good thing that I always question. It's kind of like when I graduated from college and the who's who said, would you like your name in who's who? If you buy 60 books, we'll put your name in it. And the great American cities, yeah. I mean, if it didn't cost anything, I think it'd be a great idea. But I don't think it's a wise use of our funds. So I did vote against expending the funds, and again, more importantly, devoting the staff time. It is a very time intensive activity. I voted against it, so I'm not up here to defend the decision.
Another good question and a great response from Mr. Newcomer. I totally concur with everything he just said. I'm not into awards or a waste of taxpayers' dollars just to satisfy possibly a community boondoggle. It just doesn't make a lot of sense to me. Does it bring value to the city? I think there's many arguments that say it doesn't. Is it worth having for some people? I respect their interest and their passion for it. But again, we don't have the money right now. There's better things we could be doing with $30,000, $50,000, $60,000, or $100,000. Again, going back to what Mr. Newcomer just said, staff time. You know, the staff time, we haven't even calculated the staff time that has been expended on all the other issues that I've mentioned with regards to poor decision making. So we have finite resources. It's your taxpayers' dollars. I don't like the way they've been wasted. We've got some serious issues in the city. We've got a significant, obviously, homeless problem. We've got a lack of new business coming in. People think it looks rosy, but quality businesses, I haven't seen them in the past 8 years since the recession, the rebound from the recession. A lot of cities are way ahead of us. Could we do a better job? Yes. Is it perfect? No. Are people trying? Maybe. But we continue to make some funky decisions, and it's time for a change.
Its next question, why can't we have access to bathrooms in public parks like Central Park and Broadway Park? Public health is important. We pay taxes for its upkeep. Why can't we have access to bathrooms in public parks like Central Park and Broadway Park? As public health is important, and we do pay taxes for its upkeep.
Well, forgive me, but I didn't realize there was a problem to having access to. Who raised asked that question? Okay. And what, just could you just tell me perfectly for my education, your personal experience of why you asked that question specifically? Okay, well, I'm not city staff, I'm not on city council right now, but personally speaking, it makes absolutely no sense that would be the case. I mean, it sounds rather bizarre, actually. So my only response is that all public bathrooms should be open all the time, and they should be maintained and to be of the highest health standards. And that is something that we should actually, I'd rather measure ourselves by that and that quality than rather being an all-American city. Because that would tell me we are an all-American city if we don't have such a bathroom and they are quality. So, that's exactly what we should be looking at. I mean, that's a perfect example of common sense and decency, which, you know, people People accuse me sometimes of being a little rough on city council, but when I hear stories like this, when I see the homeless on the streets, when I know of the issues that certain nonprofits are underfunded because we don't have the budget, when my kids' health is threatened and my neighbor's health is threatened, when I know all the issues and risks that were surrounded by an oil and gas project in urban areas, I take it personally, because now you're impacting something that's near and dear to my heart. So I do sort of fight back. So that's a terrible situation. It would be remedied if I was on the city council. Leave.
We agree. It shouldn't happen. They should be open. I've only experienced it once, and in that case, the answer was a temporary problem, not a systemic problem. But if it's happening at Central Park on a regular basis,
John Greenlee,
it shouldn't. I will find out and we'll stop that. It should not happen. They should be open. Yes.
Hey, candidates, what is your view on the current lawsuit from Whittier police officers against the city regarding ticketing quotas? And the second part to that question is, who is responsible for paying those legal fees?
And we feel the lawsuit is unjust. We feel we're on the correct side, and we'll let the lawsuit work its way out. Certainly, the loser will bear the cost.
But this was, I remember reading the articles about this, so I was up tonight. Could someone clarify the specifics? Was it that as I read it and understood it, was that the officers themselves felt that they were being pressurized to basically meet a quota, correct?
Yeah.
Correct? Well, I don't believe in quotas. So if that's their argument, I'm no lawyer, but if that's their argument, then I would stand with the police officers. They should be there before the making quotas. That's not their, it's like any city, you know, where you feel like you hear these horror stories that police officers have to just sit on a corner and hand out tickets because they've got to put money back in city coffers. I don't support that sort of idea of government and that idea of policing. That's not the way that you fix a budget crisis within a city. And so if their argument is based around those issues, then I would actually stand with the police officers. I would also stand with the chief of police that actually challenged the city council on this decision to hire the tow truck contract back to Hadley Tow. I spoke to Jeff Piper, the chief of police. He was against that being awarded to them. For some strange reason, it went to Hadley Tow. And coincidentally, who was the sponsor for Hadley Tow? Former council member, Mr. Greg Norbach.
We can think of a sixth thing that I disagree with my colleagues on. I was the only council member to vote against Hadley Tow on the issue of whether their contract should be suspended, and it was advised to be suspended by the police chief and the police. Hadley Tow had, the thing they did the worst was they handled evidence in a way that made the evidence unusable in the courtroom. They did not preserve and protect that evidence so it could be used. They also have had a number of cases where their drivers have been drunk while on duty and driving Hadley Tow vehicles under the influence of narcotics while driving their vehicles. This company got a, hey, be good, we'll give you a second chance. If anything, their behavior has gotten worse. It is another area where I would disagree with my colleagues.
We don't want a politically correct mayor. We want a community mayor, a community first mayor. Which will you be, Nick?
I'm definitely not politically correct, as some people say. Doesn't mean I intend not to be, because actually, I was a very good altar boy for many, many years, and I was a priest's favorite to be hired at the drop of a hat for a funeral. So. That's my Jesuit education and Catholic education has somewhat given me my passion for injustice in the world. So I'm a community guy. There's a big issue going on in this country right now as we speak that I'm somewhat indirectly involved with as well. Because this issue here locally is not just something that we deal with, it's something that's going on nationally. And there's a big sort of cultural divide going on in politics. We're seeing the crazies on the right, and we're seeing the somewhat spineless on the left, to be perfectly honest, with regards to the incumbent Democratic organization. I don't think they're doing the best for any of us. Why? Because they're all owned by special interests and corporate money, no matter if it's Democrat or Republican. They're both as guilty as each other. There's a somewhat sort of a mirror of that image in our own city. I've witnessed it for 6 years, so I know what I'm talking about. I've attended too many meetings and witnessed too many friends and families showing up at the diet, supporting bad decisions. So I'm a community guy. I stand for everybody, not anybody. I don't have business interests in Whittier. There's no motivation for me here other than stand up and do what's right for you, all of you.
Not politically correct. I am respectful. And there's a difference there. I respect people's opinion and try to deal with them with respect. Secondly, though, I have a pretty long record of voting as I think is best for the school district when I was a trustee, and voting as what's best for Whittier as a member of the city council. And sometimes those votes have been very painful in that my very good friends were on the other side of the issue. If you want an example of not being politically correct, it's focusing on the issues and being willing to make a tough decision that you know you're going to lose some friendships over, you know that there's going to be political consequences over, but because you believe it is the right decision, you do it. I believe that has been my record. I hope that's been my record. So politically correct, no, respectful, and focused on what's best for the community, always.
I'd just like to add a layer of that, because I've been the victim of some trolling and some public comments on newspaper pages and things. And all I can tell you is that my comments and my beliefs and my experiences are based, with regards to the city council, are based on 6 years of actually attending a city council meeting almost probably once a month, and being in most court hearings for the oil project, the voting rights issue. So I've witnessed things firsthand, and it's interesting that Owen uses the words respectful and political correctness or incorrectness. And people have somewhat made a comment to me, well, you're not respectful. Well, you know what? I stood in front of the council with dozens and dozens of other people, more than dozens, hundreds of people. Just take the voting, just take the oil issue for a specific instance. We were very respectful, for many, many months. But, well, our voices were never listened to by the Planning Commission and the City Council. We were totally disrespected. Now, you can give various definitions of respect and disrespect, but when you're voting, when you're fighting for right and just, and when you know that you are, and yet you're still not given the time of day, the local media is used against you, and that nobody listens, at some point you're gonna get a little bit heated with it. So we're never mean to be disrespectful, but when I know something is right, I'm not gonna back down, and I'm gonna stand up and fight the truth.
We have reduced our water consumption by 40%, yet our water bill went from $100 to $300 per billing period. $240 is for service fees. How do you expect people to sustain this? Owen?
Thank you for that question. We haven't quite saved 40%, but we've done a very good job of saving. But the question about the billing, it's because of the rate structure that I voted against. We went from a system that was $3 for connecting to the pipe, and the rest was your usage, to a system now that 80% of what you pay is connecting to the pipe, and only 20% is based on your usage. And so our connection fees went from $3 to $40, $50, $60 a month. You get billed every 2 months, the numbers rack up. The problem, obviously, paying more is painful, but it's not even paying more in a way that will conserve water and meet the goals of better water usage and pipes that aren't breaking and system that gives you pure water. It's a bad way to go about a problem that needs a solution. We need the solution. We can't avoid it. We can't go back to the old $3 a month, but we could do a much better job of basing it on your usage and protecting and improving the system so it's here for the next 30, 40, 50, and 100 years.
I agree with everything that Mr. Newcomer just said. I'd just like to add another layer to that. Again, I hate to sound like a broken record, but I'm going to be one. Bad planning. You know, again, we knew the drought was coming. I knew it was coming, and I'm not a scientist, because I listen to people who are a lot smarter than me. And part of being a council member or mayor is to make sure that you're listening to people that know more about something than you do. That's the same thing as like when you're running a business. When you're a CEO of a company, you're not the expert on every issue within that company. You hire a team of people that are the experts. Your goal is to get those experts to get working on your behalf to deliver results. Where this has been a very reactive city council for many, 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 many years. We knew there was a drought coming. The other thing we knew about oil and gas projects was what? Oil and gas projects waste millions and millions of gallons of water in the production of oil and gas. Part of our argument was that we could not afford to do this. On infrastructure, we knew that the heavy trucks on the roads would continue to destroy the infrastructure that we had because the pipes were too close to the surface and plus they hadn't been touched in decades. But again, we didn't plan for this. We should have been doing all these things reacting to this decades ago. But if you don't understand the issues, if you don't believe in the science, well, look, I mean, how are you going to react in a positive and proactive manner? We can't be reactive, we've got to be proactive. That's what I do every day professionally. That's what I'll bring to the city council.
That's right. It would have been better if councils before us had started this process 20 years ago. They didn't. This city council saw the problem before the drought ever came up, because we've been working on solving this problem for 5, 6, 7 years, depending on whether it's the water system, the sewer system, the street system. In fact, the street system going to our new system started about a decade ago. Why? We realized that the city wasn't investing enough in maintaining its infrastructure and updating its infrastructure and improving it. And we are doing that. It didn't just start a year ago. It didn't start when headlines on the drought came about. It started before that. We can't go back 20 years, but we do need to get caught up. And we do need to get it going, and we have.
Last formal question, and then we're going to provide 2 minutes each for the candidates to speak, as we do have to wrap up by 3:30. So question is, why is the city planning to nickel and dime us by installing parking meters? Many of us are on fixed income. Stop nickel and diming us. Nick.
Nickel and diming. I mean, again, why do we need to look for more revenue on parking meters or whatever the opportunity may be? I haven't looked hard and fast at the financials of what sort of revenues would be generated from parking meters, but my general philosophy as a council member is that obviously I don't want to throw the burden of smaller issues like that on taxpayers. There should be adequate parking in our community. I don't know why they even charge $2 in the parking structure, the main parking structure. That should be free. We should be encouraging people to come and shop and hang out in our community. I mean, I haven't got all the answers fiscally because I don't have access to the data. So I don't like to make guesses at something that I'm not truly informed about. But philosophically, it doesn't make any sense to me. I'm actually a fiscally conservative individual. I don't like to spend money that we don't have. Now, we have a city council that, from a partisan perspective, has 3 Republicans on it. There's no fiscal conservatism in how they do business. I don't think they even understand business. They seem to waste money. But I'm not for it. I don't want to put the small burdens on our community. And we should be, and Uptown's a great opportunity to continue to build a good business district that still hasn't met its needs or goals yet. Thank you.
The whole goal of having parking meters uptown is to encourage short-term parking right in front of the businesses, open up more parking right in front of the businesses, and allow customers to more conveniently get to those businesses. The problem right now is there's a lot of people who park for hours, sometimes all day, in a spot right in front of business. Parking meters would discourage that, and that's the purpose of parking meters. It's to shift long-term parking a block away and free up and preserve open spaces for short-termers. The logic, if I gotta pay a quarter or a buck, I might do that to run in for 30 minutes. But if I had to pay all day, and we wouldn't allow it for all day, then we're talking about, well, I'm not gonna pay 10 bucks to park there all day. I'll go where it's free. And so the whole purpose, with the support of the uptown business community, is to shift long-term parking off of the main thoroughfares in front of the businesses and encourage short-term parking in front of the businesses so that more customers can get into that business. Ideally, we have 10 customers, each of whom park for a half hour, instead of one customer who parked for 5 hours in front of your business. That's the logic. It is supported by the Uptown Business District, and we'll hope it works. Obviously, I don't like paying for parking either. On the other hand, I realize the logic, and we're trying to be good partners with the Uptown businesses to help them help their customers get to their store, and parking meters are an integral part of that goal.
I'd like to add a layer to that. I don't necessarily agree with the logic. I'm sympathetic to the concerns of the business owners, but I don't necessarily agree to the logic of the meters. I mean, if you want to put time constraints on parking, just put a little plaque up there, 2-hour parking, 1-hour parking, whatever you want it to be. But you don't have to put a meter there unless you're looking to, as some people may think, nickel and dime the community. I mean, we want the uptown area to be one where people are encouraged to come and to participate, to hang out, and to build that community. That's why one of my big issues, again, we haven't really talked about today, but is community policing, getting police officers back on the street, back on their feet. I talked about this to Jeff Piper only in the last couple of weeks. It's something he would love to see. We're told we don't have the money. If you stop wasting millions of dollars on lawsuits that you never win, we would have the money. I mean, it's perfect common sense. So if there's an issue with timing for business owners, then put a sign up there. Do something practical. If you need to put, you know, in various cities, they put a chalk mark on your tire and they measure your time or whatever, their parking attendance. If people are going to be there all day, they're going to end up getting a ticket. So it's a lot more than the parking meter. So I think you're motivated not to be there and hang out.
Okay, we're
going to
get 2 minutes each. Owen, you can start with your 2 minutes.
Thank you very much. I ask for your vote. I think I can be the unifying leader. I think I can show that my practical, principled skills that I've used over time will best serve this community. My openness, indication that I'm here, and I go to every forum that I get invited to. I go to every opportunity to meet with constituents that I have the ability to get to. I don't pick and choose who I talk to or limit the access to me. Now, I've had the experience, been on the City Council for 16 years. I have the commitment to the new system. I signed the argument in favor of the districts and the mayor's system, which I think is the best solution that we have here. And I'm in tune with my walking and my service through the classroom. But something final I leave with. City Council member also needs to work with others in the community at the state level and the national level. I'm proud to have the support of Congresswoman Linda Sanchez. I'm proud to be the chair of the Employees Relations Committee for the League of California Cities. I'm proud to be a former chair of the League's Environmental Quality Committee for the state of California for the cities. I'm proud to be the longest serving member on the Los Angeles Homeless Services Commission. And we're getting $14 million new funding. I am proud to have authored an article last week in the Whittier Daily News advocating in favor of a state bill that will dedicate money that's under a proposition for mental health to use that for those who are mentally ill and facing homelessness. as a way to get new funds to help those facing homelessness. I'm proud to be chair of the Gateway Cities COG, which is 27 cities in the Southeast area. I'm chair of their homeless committee. I serve on the Vector Control Board. I have shown my ability to focus on problems, solve problems, bring people together, and make Whittier a better place. With your help, I'll continue that as mayor.
Thank you for your time. Thanks for coming today. It's disappointing that Mr. Vinatieri didn't have the decency to show. But it is what it is. I mean, it's a reflection of sort of a little bit of the divide that exists in the city that no one really wants to admit to. I'm not here to be a troublemaker. I'm here to move the city forward. My professional background is something completely unique that no other city council member has. The times of council members being local community residents who like to dabble in politics has moved on. We need professional people who have a professional background that can bring something unique and different to this city and help move the city forward together. I've been endorsed in the past by the Los Angeles County Democratic Party. I've been endorsed by firefighters, by labor, by numerous business groups. I've served on numerous business boards, you name it, I've done it. And on that issue of boards, one thing I didn't mention today, and it's a fact, sadly, the performance of this city council over the past 6 years that I've witnessed, based on the decisions that they've collectively made, including Mr. Newcomer and Vinatieri, if they were judged by the standards of the public board of directors, they would either be all criminally indicted or under civil prosecution. I'm deadly serious. I work with public boards. The decisions that they've made that have impacted the value of the city, to be translated to a public company, would be the value of that company's stock, where it would be plummeting, where you would see shareholder revolt, civil action, the class action lawsuits. All of them would be under investigation. They've made some horrifically bad decisions for the wrong reasons. Nothing personal, just that this is a community of 90,000 people that needs to move forward and move forward together. I urge you to truly consider the decisions that you've made in the past. And if it's not me, that's okay. If it's somebody other than me, someone new, great. But we need new ideas, qualified ideas, an educated perspective, and we need to do it together. I've got all the necessary credentials with regards to decision making. Do I have the qualifications that Mr. Newcomer or an incumbent would have? Of course not. It's impossible. It's impossible for a challenger to do that. But do I have the professional acumen to do it? Absolutely. Do I have a unique skill set? Absolutely. Do I have the passion? Absolutely. Do I have new ideas? Absolutely. Am I conflicted? Absolutely not. So I encourage you to talk to your neighbors and show up with your support. Thank you.
And I also ask you to take a look at my flyer. This is the one I'm leaving at doors as I walk through the community. And again, went over 4,000 yesterday. And there's also a support form back there. Would love to add your name to my supporter list or a sign in your yard in a couple of weeks. Thank you very much.